And on the final lap of the conversations this morning, we, of course, will be talking a little bit more about COVID-19, but in a different, you know, from a different angle. The World Bank and its predictions, you know, are not very exciting with regards to the economies in Africa as we get into another wave of the, you know, pandemic. We've, of course, known and seen what, you know, African countries, Nigeria in particular, suffered with the first wave of the COVID-19 virus. And of course, the predictions from the World Bank don't, you know, seem to, you know, be any better. We've invited this morning Mr. Mukhtar Mohammed to join us and share his thoughts on this. Good morning, Mr. Mohammed.
Good morning. Compliments of the season.
Same to you. Thank you very much for stepping in and for your time. I want, you know, your thoughts, basically, if, you know, if this is coming as a shock to you, or of course, you know, you basically had expected that this is how it would play out with regards to the economies across Africa.
Definitely. It's even coming as a surprise that we will still have a little bit of growth in Africa. Because the pandemic, if there's any economy that the pandemic has ravaged, it's African economy. We will not see those impacts. Maybe you start seeing those impacts when we finally open up the economy and you begin to see the type of result that will be coming out, especially from quoted company and also from SME spaces. Also, you begin to see those numbers and, you know, the impact. Then again, which we've already experienced, the number of job losses, and there might be an increment in that, especially if we are not able to curtail the spread of the second wave, like what is happening in South Africa already, which is an African country. So I'm not surprised what the World Bank have just said, and I'm pretty surprised that the numbers are even better, not worse than what we think it will be. But that is not all bad news. I think what we'll see, as long as the second wave is not eating deep into Africa, like what we've seen with the numbers that are coming out, and then there could be light at the end of the tunnel for Africa going forward.
Okay, all right.
And looking at the economics of COVID, how would you estimate the loss that Nigeria has experienced in financial terms?
We're still combining those numbers, and it's going to run into billions of dollars. We remember, even before the first lockdown, the Lagos State Chambers of Commerce, even that was within a week, we were estimating about 700 and something billion lost within a week. Then remember that we had the NSAS protests that came in. Also, then we now have the second wave of the pandemic, which have reduced activities, especially in the civil service, whereby some civil servants are stay at home. Even major companies are still working from home. All these are always going to have impact in the area of transportation. Transportation sector, I mean, a lot of people will not be going there. So that sector also will suffer when the GDP numbers comes out. So it's going to be really, really high in terms of financial terms. We might be looking in billions of dollars, especially when you look at Nigeria. Also, remember that our major cash cow is crude oil, and that also was really heavily affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. And even up to now, just this morning, we heard that OPEC have said that OPEC nations should reduce their output by about 1.9 million barrels. So you will see all those numbers playing out for the short term.
All right. Is there also, because I read the report and it says here that policymakers must put in place comprehensive reforms and policies to improve the fundamental drivers of equitable and sustainable economic growth. How do you think that we may also be able to do that? You know, are there things that we may have done as a nation that would have helped us, you know, see some balance with regards to our economy and not have the full effects that the World Bank is describing?
Well, they'll have a lot that would have done. And unfortunately, it's not what we do when the pandemic came in. It's supposed to be what we have been doing before we had the pandemic. We're supposed to act like a buffer in case we have any external shock or even internal shock. Unfortunately, Nigeria as a nation does not have those structures down. The basic problem that is affecting Nigeria is weak infrastructure. When you have a weak infrastructure, it has a way of affecting the fundamentals of your economy. And so that is what we are suffering as a nation. Not that we don't have the well within to get out of the pandemic to be better, to be better than other African countries, but we have weak structures, and weak structures as a result of weak institutions. Weak institutions is a result that we don't build institutions, we build strong men. So once those strong men are out of this institution goes back to where they used to be. So the challenge for us as a nation is not if we have the well within, is do we have the infrastructure? Do we have the structure? We don't have it. So definitely, the more we can do is to do with what we have now. Look at it. If you look at the intervention that we've had from the private sector, from the government in terms of liquidity into the system, in terms of cash transfer, you can see this impact was not well felt because of the weak structure. And weak structure also could be as a result of weak data. And these are not things that you achieve within the shortest possible time. These are things you achieve through long-term planning. So we don't have that. And so definitely we are going to suffer for that. Is there any way we can do it? Well, what the government is doing, especially the monetary policy, is to see how they can inject direct funding into key sectors, which is normally not supposed to be their own responsibility. But once you have the monetary policy doing what they are doing, and the fiscal policy, which has to do with government policies, not doing what they have to do, then you have what we see now. So what CBN is doing is looking at areas, food production, impacting those areas, and seeing how you could use those areas to begin to impact other areas. So what we are seeing now is a direct intervention from institutions that are supposed to be policy makers to make sure the fundamentals of the economy are stable.
And the statistics for developing countries has been gloomy since the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic. Now we're in a recession. It's even worse now with the World Bank statistics. You did mention some points earlier, but in addition to that, what else do you think can help us get out of this?
Well, what can help us get out of this is for government to get their act together and begin to look at structures that can help the economy get out of it. And one of those key places you need to look at is you begin to look at SMEs. And how do you help the SMEs? You begin to look at tax rebate for the SMEs. You saw Lagos State doing it in terms of when we had the NSAS protest. They decided that some other companies will not be giving tax rebate from a particular time until they are able to stabilize. That's how government, because it has been proven that 98% of the employment opportunities come from the SME space. So those are the space that you try to impact directly. If you are able to impact those space directly, you realize that the job losses will not be that much. And again, that also will now help in terms of homes, because they are affecting families. So families will now begin to benefit in terms of payment of their bills, in terms of consumer index perception will go a little bit high. They will be able to consume things. They will be able to buy what they need, their basic necessity. And that will in turn have a boomerang effect in the economy. So if you ask me what space the government should be looking, think of how you can impact SMEs. Which of those SMEs that you think are going to be add up to the GDP of the economy and also add up to employability of Nigerians. Then you intervene directly to those SMEs. The developed nations have done it. What they do is that they call the SMEs company in terms and say, look, how many staff do you have? They said, oh, we have about five staffs. He said, okay, but we are trying to lay off three. Say, look, no, don't lay off those three. We as a government, we are going to pay the salaries for those three. And then we'll give you a tax bracket. And then we'll see how your company can go. We'll do this for the next 6 months. We'll do this for the next 1 year. That is a way that we can definitely tame the trail of the type of prediction that's been predicted by the World Bank.
Mukhtar Mohammed, unfortunately, we are out of time for this conversation. But we, of course, would have our fingers crossed and see that the Nigerian government, or hope that the Nigerian government does some of the things that you've mentioned. And, of course, we'll definitely be inviting you in again to share your thoughts with us. Good morning. Thanks for joining us once again.
Thanks again.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
All right. Fortunately, it's the poorest, of the people in the population that get to, of course, suffer most of these the effects of these economic issues.
Indeed, lots of people are out of work, and that's even what's most scary. Even the brightest of them. I mean, I know people were finished from the University of Benin together. They had first-class degrees. They still can't get jobs, and there are millions of people like that in Nigeria. And look at gloomy statistics from the World Bank. It just doesn't seem to be getting any better.
Not in any way.
It's so sad. But let's talk sports after this break with Udoka Njoku.